Well, this is predominantly in Kandahar, where in the last day we've seen massive parade, victory parades, frankly, at the home, essentially, of the evolution of the Taliban. Kandahar is where it all began in the early 1990s. They launched their campaign and captured the country in 2001, and it's from there that they've seemed to be celebrating what they are seeing as a victory with a parade of US-built MRAP vehicles, those wheeled armoured vehicles that have been captured from the Afghan National Army. They've even managed to get a Black Hawk helicopter into the air, all rubbing the noses of the Afghans and indeed the coalition veterans, of course, overwhelming majority of them Americans, in what from the Taliban perspective is a victory. But by Friday, Jake, they have to establish themselves as a government, and it's going to be a lot harder to establish themselves as a government in the context that they now face of an insurgency potentially from ISIS-K, continuing resistance against their rule in the Panjshir Valley, and a fractious warlord, ethnically riven nation with not enough troops to police it. So they're going to be up against it themselves, but they are allowing themselves a bit of a victory celebration at the moment, Jake.
All right, Sam Kiley, thank you so much. Joining us now in studio, Craig Whitlock. He's an investigative reporter for The Washington Post. He's author of the brand new book, The Afghanistan Papers, A Secret History of the War. The book builds off a 2019 investigative report that was tediously obtained through multiple Freedom of Information Act requests and two federal lawsuits. Craig, thanks so much for joining us. Good to see you again. The war in Afghanistan has lasted longer than World War I, World War II, and the Vietnam War combined. Do you think in some ways the sheer length of the war destined it for failure?
Well, absolutely. I mean, if a war is dragging on for 20 years, by definition, it's not going very well, particularly if your side started it. So I think this war hasn't been going well for a long time. In fact, U.S. presidents have been trying to end it for at least 7 years. President Obama tried to end it before the end of his second term. President Trump tried to end it. Neither of them could do it, and it finally fell to President Biden.
One of the many fascinating and disturbing anecdotes in your book has to do with then Vice President Dick Cheney, almost killed on purpose, assassinated by the Taliban when he went to Bagram Air Base right outside Kabul. U.S. military officials really tried to cover it up. They claimed he was never in harm's way. And what's most remarkable about this, and you and I have talked about this before, the Taliban told the truth about that incident and the U.S. military lied.
That's right. And at that time, people took the U.S. government, the military's word for it, that Cheney wasn't a target. But in documents we obtained for the Afghanistan papers, there was an oral history interview with an Army officer who was in charge of security at Bagram Air Base, was in charge of protecting Cheney that day. And he said the suicide bomber came within 30 minutes of killing Cheney before he was due to leave the base. And the only reason the suicide bomber missed is he saw the wrong armored SUV convoy coming out of the front. So they said this was a close call, even though the U.S. military denied that Cheney could have been a target or that he was ever in danger.
I relied on your book yesterday. I was talking to Obama and Bush's former war czar, for lack of a better term, Doug Lute, retired ambassador, retired general, who is quoted in the Afghanistan papers through the Lessons Learned project that the Special Inspector General for Afghanistan did, talking about how for years and years the U.S. never had any idea what they were doing in Afghanistan. They didn't even understand Afghanistan. This is what he told me when I asked about it.
Our fundamental understanding of Afghanistan was often at the 101 college level, and we needed master's degrees.
And to be honest, it's 101 college level is a compliment compared to some of the evidence I've seen in my research about Afghanistan. I've seen intelligence reports that were based on Wikipedia. Did the U.S. ever really understand Afghanistan?
I don't think so, Jake, and that's one reason why the war lasted as long as it did. You had troops, diplomats, aid workers. They would cycle in for 6, 9, 12 months at a time. Then the new guy would come in, and they would have to learn from scratch again. Troops weren't trained in the local languages. After 20 years, there was hardly anybody in the U.S. government who could speak Afghan languages. So we were doomed to repeat the same rookie mistakes time and again.
The comparison to the Pentagon Papers is stark. The idea that your book, The Afghanistan Papers, compared to the Pentagon Papers. The Pentagon Papers were about how the U.S. government and military leaders knew they were losing the war in Vietnam, and yet they kept lying about it. That's the harsh term. Putting on a good face or spinning it positively or being optimistic is a more generous term. Did you anticipate a similar reaction to your book as the harsh reaction that came out to the Pentagon Papers? They tried to stop the publication of it.
Well, the difference between the documents I obtained and the Pentagon Papers was a classified top secret study that was leaked by Daniel Ellsberg to the New York Times, Washington Post, and other newspapers. The documents we obtained were unclassified, but it took us 3 years to go to the courts to force the government to release them. But some of those same admissions are in there. There was one interview with an Obama National Security Council official, someone who worked at the White House, saying that throughout the duration of the war, they manipulated all the metrics, he called them, all the statistics and measurements that show how the war was going well or not. He said they always manipulated them going up to the White House to make it look like things were going well. And he said it was to, one, make the people in charge look good, and two, to make sure that popular support for the war didn't diminish. So, yes, they were lying, and they were manipulating public opinion.
Robert Gates, who was the Secretary of Defense under Bush, and then under Obama, said this in 2013, quote, "The reality is that on 9/11, we didn't know jack shit about al-Qaeda." Apologies for the language, but I'm quoting a Secretary of Defense. Did the intel improve more significantly after 9/11?
I think the intel did improve, but the problem was there was a disconnect between what the intelligence agencies were saying and what the military commanders were saying in public. The intelligence agencies were very pessimistic about how the war was going. They noted that the Taliban continued to gain strength, that the Afghan army was getting weaker, wasn't competent enough to defend their own country. But the intelligence officials would only appear in public maybe once or twice a year before Congress, give these very brief statements. In contrast, the generals, the presidents, would stand up in public all the time and give a very different account, give a very positive account that things were always moving in the right direction. So this was well known by the intelligence agencies, but they were sort of constrained by they don't talk in public very much.
When I asked a former commanding general about the idea that the Afghan military fell apart and was that evidence that generals had been lying to the public about how efficient the military had been, he pushed back on that. And his argument was it wasn't that they didn't have the capability to fight towards the end. It was that they lacked the will, and they lacked the will because, A, the U.S. was pulling out, as established by the Trump administration in negotiations with the Taliban and reaffirmed by President Biden. And B, it's also been explained to me that it's quite possible that a lot of military leaders in the Afghanistan army and a lot of Afghan politicians were cutting secret deals with the Taliban. How do you respond to that, that it's more about the lack of will than a lack of ability?
Well, I think that's all true. There was a lack of will at the end, but part of that reason is there's an endemic corruption with the Afghan military leadership. They were pocketing the salaries of their own troops. They were stealing fuel. They were stealing ammunition. So if you're a frontline soldier with the Afghan army, where is your will to fight if your commander is leaving you out to dry? But the thing is, U.S. military officials have known this for more than a decade, that there was not only a lack of will to fight, but that they were poorly equipped, poorly trained. We see interview after interview with military trainers saying the Afghans couldn't shoot straight, they couldn't read, they couldn't count, they couldn't tell their colors. This was an ongoing problem for over a decade, and yet the U.S. generals in public kept saying they were making progress and the Afghan forces were going to do the job.
And one other observation I might make is if you're a captain or a major in Afghanistan, you don't get promoted. You don't get a ribbon for saying, I can't train these soldiers. You get promoted, you get a ribbon for saying, they're better than they were when I took over.
Well, not only that, Jake, but in the documents we obtained, a lot of the trainers, the majors, the colonels were told, if you don't certify that this Afghan unit is ready, is prepared to take over security for a province or a district, you have to sign that they are, whether you think so or not. It was almost an order that they had to certify that these troops were ready.